Welcome to worship. It is December. Christmas time is coming. It is the second Sunday of Advent. Advent is a time of preparation and waiting. As we prepared the sanctuary, we have these beautiful poinsettias. One is from the youth, and the other one is in memory of Jan Johnson from her children, Joan and Jerry, and of course, Swanee also. The word Advent comes from the Latin word Adventus, which means coming or arrival. As we prepare for worship today, let's gather the elements for communion, and let us prepare ourselves for the coming of Jesus. And like always, we begin worship with a song.
To worship. Come forth, Advent. Come as a twinkling guest, ever giving and forgiving. Come as a dancing flame, proclaiming the adventure. Come as the guiding light of patience, love, and forgiveness. Come as the sweet light of breaking dawn. Come as the quiet, sweet, golden twilight. Come as the twinkle in God's eye, brightening our world. Come as eternal love and promise of the season. O come, Emmanuel. Come and be welcomed. And now please join me in our opening prayer. O God, we are challenged during these days of Advent. Our lives are much changed since last Advent, and we are growing impatient. In this worship, strengthen our hearts, center our minds, and help us with patience, for your coming is near. Create among us the holy that only you can provide. We pray as your people, O Lord. Amen.
Our lists are long, even in this strange mess where we live these days. And we want to do it right. We want to be safe, but we want to be able to enjoy the season. We've got work to do to put right what has gone wrong, to heal what is broken, to amend the relationships, and to prepare for the company that will come.
The prophet Isaiah reminded us that there is work to be done. Prepare the way of the Lord. Make straight in the desert a highway for our God. When God comes in, then healing is to be found. But we need to make the way. We need to open the door into our lives.
So we light these candles as a sign of our faith that the God that we worship is not far from us, and that we can clear the way for that God to come and dwell with us. We light these candles in faith that company is coming. O come, Emmanuel.
In the little village of Bethlehem, there lay a child one day, and the sky was bright with a holy light o'er the place where Jesus lay. Alleluia, oh how the angels sing. Alleluia, how it rang. And the sky was bright with a holy light. 'Twas the birthday of a king. 'Twas a humble birthplace, but oh, how much God gave to us that day. From the manger bed, what a path has led, what a perfect holy way. Alleluia, oh how the angels sing. Alleluia, how it rang. And the sky was bright with a holy light. 'Twas the birthday of a king.
Listen, if you will, to a wonderful story that comes to us from Luke, the first chapter, the 67th verse through the 80th verse. Zechariah has just seen his baby John, who we will call the Baptist, and he breaks into prophecy and song. Then his father, Zechariah, was filled with the Holy Spirit and spoke this prophecy. Blessed be the Lord God of Israel, for he has looked favorably on his people and redeemed them. He has raised up a mighty Savior for us in the house of his servant David, as he spoke through the mouth of his holy prophets from of old, that we would be saved from our enemies and from the hand of all who hate us. Thus he has shown the mercy promised to our ancestors and has remembered his holy covenant, the oath that he swore to our ancestor Abraham, to grant us that we, being rescued from the hands of our enemies, might serve him without fear in holiness and righteousness before him all our days. And you, child, will be called the prophet of the Most High, for you will go before the Lord to prepare his ways, to give knowledge of salvation to his people by the forgiveness of their sins. By the tender mercy of our God, the dawn from on high will break upon us, to give light to those who sit in darkness, and in the shadow of death to guide our feet into the ways of peace. And the child grew and became strong in spirit, and he was in the wilderness until the day he appeared publicly to Israel. Here ends a reading from God's holy word. Would you pray with me? Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of each one gathered to praise you this day be found acceptable in your sight, O Lord, for truly you are the rock and the redeemer. Amen. The great cellist Pavlos Kassels, in his autobiography that he called Joys and Sorrows, recalls the very first time that he went to church on Christmas Eve. He was 5 years old, and he walked hand in hand with his father through the quiet streets from their house to the church in the small village where Pavlov's father was the church organist. As he walked, Pavlov shivered, and the night seemed mysterious, and Pavlov shivered as he walked. Listen to his own words this morning. I felt that something wonderful was about to happen. High overhead, the heavens were filled with stars. We walked in silence in the narrow, dark streets. There were moving figures, shadowy, spectral, and silent too. And then suddenly, there was a burst of light flooding from the open doors of the church, and we moved into that light silently. Then, just as suddenly, my father broke the silence with music from the organ, and we all sang. And when I sang, it was my heart that was singing, and I poured out everything that was within me. Even as an old man, Kassels recalled the holiness of that night. This is what he wrote. From the moment I heard the first notes of the organ, I was overwhelmed. I have never heard such a beautiful sound before. A radiance filled me, and I felt I could not breathe. Are you in touch with that kind of experience? When you shivered, though there was no chill in the air? Holiness, we would describe it. And some people today would say that holiness seems to be a tad more fleeting than it was in biblical times. After all, we cannot measure holiness as we might the flower for a cake or the numbers on the Dow Jones. But the holy still exists. Holiness still can still be felt as our souls remain open to God and all that God provides. In today's reading, the writer of Luke tells of a time when Zechariah experienced holiness as he served in the temple. And Luke builds the story carefully, reminding us that God had promised to send a Messiah, a Savior. And yet, for more than 400 years, no voice of the prophet or further prophecy had been heard in the land. The people waited and waited, for word of the Messiah, and God was silent. Would God keep the promise, they began to ask themselves? Would God prove to be faithful? It was as if God's people were going through a long, cold, dark winter. Would morning ever come? God's ways are not our ways. God's schedule is not our own. God acts in unexpected places, unexpected ways, and in unexpected times to create the holy. There is an old story about Philip Brooks, who was the composer of our carol, O Little Town of Bethlehem. He was found pacing back and forth in his study by a parishioner who said, "What's the matter, Philip?" And the parishioner questioned further. Brooks replied, "I guess that it boils down to the fact that I'm in a hurry and God doesn't seem to be." Now, Zachariah and his wife Elizabeth, both very old in age, must have experienced something of the same concern. God was in no hurry to fulfill their heart's greatest desires. It's a little bit like waiting on an adoption list, except for the fact that it isn't 6 years that you wait. It was years and years and decades for this older couple. They had been barren for years, never holding the baby that they had prayed for, their heart's desires. The years multiplied, and they were very old. But seemingly, God was in no hurry. Suddenly, one day, as the priest Zechariah was serving in the temple, an angel comes and reminded him that God always keeps God's word. A child who was purposed to prepare for the Messiah and for the Messiah's mission would be born to very old Elizabeth and Zechariah. Now, words of an angel, as I serve in a church, would make my spine shiver. And yet the angel's proclamation didn't exactly strike a responsive chord within Zechariah. He didn't leave the temple singing, "Great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father." He left unable to sing or speak at all until he looked at his newborn child several months later, and Zechariah's voice returned. He sang. He proclaimed God's holy presence in our midst. The long-awaited child, whom we best remember as John the Baptist, was given. Now, this story of barrenness and promises kept creates the doorway through which we see the ultimate gift of God, the fulfillment of promises in the child of Bethlehem, Jesus Christ. In a particular moment, God created, and the world was blessed with holiness. Can you get in touch with Zechariah's joy? We live in difficult times, don't we? Are you finding it difficult to believe that in God's time, a pandemic will leave, a resident pastor will actually come, tensions will ease in our world, and we'll have vaccinations in our arms? It's tough and unpredictable as the year 2020 has been, Zechariah lived in a time that was even more difficult than our own. Once a proud people, things had become very difficult in Zechariah's little nation. The shadow of mighty Rome lay across the land. Barracks of Roman soldiers were common sights in the street. The people groaned under an oppressive and growingly oppressive burden of taxes, and there was a seething restlessness, not unknown in our own day, that lay just below the surface. Darkness and death stalked the land. Times were bleak, but as he gazed upon the fulfillment of prayers, Zechariah encouraged the people to believe. In God's timing, he sang, God's promises are always fulfilled, and Christ transformed every doubt into holiness. Are you in touch with the sacred? Are there moments you can recall when nothing short of a shiver ran up and down your spine because you experienced not cold, but God's holiness, God's presence in your life? Such moments quietly sneak in upon us, and yet they are real. They come unannounced, just as the angel's visit to Zechariah was unannounced, and yet they are very real. And they don't just happen in worship. What difference can holiness make in your life? or when the holiness of Christ's presence is allowed into every nook and cranny of our lives, into every decision of every day, lives are changed. After all, if Christ sits with you at a morning staff meeting, can you treat colleagues with anything less than justice and love? When dinner becomes a holy moment, can tirades and tantrums pass back and forth across the table? When we greet one another in Christian love, rather than with cold rudeness or a blank face, does it not bind the faithful to one another and allow us to impact the world for good and not evil? To change the words of Pablo Casals just a little bit, there are times when men and women are so in touch with the holy that we sing, and yet it is our hearts that sing and not just our voices. We pour out everything that is within us. And our song shares holiness in a world so often filled with darkness and dread. I know that within our congregation there are people who sing with their hearts. I hear it every time I'm in the office and Beth sings with beauty. Christians cannot be in touch with the holiness of God just so we are rude or we complain about our surroundings or our lives. Christ's presence allows us to make our surroundings holy so that we might feel every holy moment followed by righteous living. Today, might we join with Zechariah in singing the praises of God, who in God's timing sent the Messiah, who can forgive our sins, give light to those who sit in darkness and in the shadow of death, guide our footsteps into the ways of peace and joy. In the days of Advent which stretch before us, in all the ways you can, may you be mindful that God keeps every promise. The promised one who came can come again to you. After our prayer time, we will come to the table of the Lord. And may we be mindful as we do of each moment of our lives, giving meaning to those moments, making holiness a part of every nation, every action, every thought, every plan. For by the tender mercy of our God, the dawn from on high came once and is promised again at a time of God's own choosing. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen.
Oh, holy night, the stars are brightly shining. This is the night of the dear Savior's birth. Long lay the soul felt its worth. A thrill of hope the weary soul rejoices, for yonder breaks a new and glorious morn. Oh, is love, and his gospel is peace. Chains shall he break, for the slave is a brother, and in his name all oppression shall cease. Sweet hymns of joy in grateful chorus raise we, let all within us praise his holy name.
We come to our prayer time on this second Sunday of Advent. We come bearing the joys and the frustrations of our lives. I invite you to be silent before God in silent prayer, sharing your needs and your joys before we pray together. Let there be silence. Eternal God, for whom all people wait and search even when they do not realize it, we cry out this morning for a word from you. Open our eyes that have been closed by fear and blinded by self-pity, that we may see you even in the greatest anxiety and uncertainty that beset our days and threaten to overwhelm us like a cloud of darkness. Help us to see that even as we wrap packages and purchase gifts in the midst of hustle and bustle, which really is much less than it was before the pandemic, help us to see, help us to know that you have become incarnate, sanctifying the smallest tasks of love, generosity, and kindness that we are enabled by your grace to perform. We think of the needs of others at this time, O Lord, and we are embarrassed by our own selfishness. May the answer to our prayers begin with us to redeem the time, bring to all who are in need the alleviation of poverty, of comfort for their minds and spirits. Enable us to do that which we can to help them, to share in their joy and prosperity, but also to provide a listening ear or a friendly word and to do an errand or an act of kindness. But let us not be content so long as conditions exist that foster human distress through the repetition of ignorance and filth, disease, pandemic, hunger, war, poverty. We pray, O Lord, that the promise of your birth, that peace shall be on earth, may soon be fulfilled in our troubled hearts and in our world. Come to us, Lord, for we need your presence in our own lives. We pray especially for those who are dear to us, who have become sick, who have been hospitalized, who are troubled or unsure, who are near the hour of their death or who are grieving the death of a loved one. Comfort, comfort your people, O Lord, and fill each heart with your love. Touch us anew with the hope that is in the heritage of those who love you and trust your promises. Through Jesus Christ, who is the joy of those who are happy and the comfort of those who mourn, as we join the church in our family prayer. We remember that prayer as it has been taught to us by Jesus Christ, who shared it with his disciples, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. We gather today at the family table, a table of the Lord where communion of bread and the cup are spread. And this table has not been made with human hands or anything but human hands. It has been prepared by Jesus Christ, who offers us grace sufficient for the needs of our lives. If you were at home, perhaps you have already picked up at the church enough communion elements that can be taken home for our services of communion. But if not, this is a good time to get bread and to get juice. You know, throughout the world, they do not use communion bread or wafer or even bread, and they certainly do not have access to grape juice. They use other elements, simple elements that are part of their daily life. And in this time of pandemic, I encourage you to do exactly that. Maybe you're holding a coffee cup or a glass of water or some juice, and you have bread. God sees our needs, and God's communion will be effective, whatever you use. On the night in which Jesus was betrayed, he took bread and he broke it, and he gave it to his disciples, saying, Take and eat. This is my body broken for you. And he also took the leftover wine from the Passover meal, and he shared it once again with his closest followers, saying, This is my blood poured out for you and for many for the remission of sins. As often as we eat or drink, let us do it in the name of Christ Jesus our Lord. This is the bread of heaven, the body of our Lord Jesus Christ. This is the cup of thanksgiving, the blood of Jesus Christ, grace sufficient for the needs of your lives. Let us pray. Lord, we thank you for this gift of grace, this meal, this momentous meal in which you remind us that you love us and forgive us. We ask, O Lord, that as we go into the world, we might feed others, we might grace others, we might tell your story of the baby in Bethlehem, grown to be a man, who was crucified for our sins, and who forgives the world. In the name of Jesus Christ, we thank you. Amen.
Please keep the following people in your prayers this week: Pastor Chris, Betty, Jan, Bob and Gwen, Nels, Judy, Nancy, baby Eli, Marland, Patty and family, the family of Neil on his passing, Bob, Amy and her family on her sister's passing. This week we celebrate with the following people. Happy birthday to Griffin, Tyson, Sylvia, Marlo, Braden, Linda, Tammy, and Cam. And happy anniversary to Randy and Nancy, Marv and Colleen, and David and Joyce. We're still in the red phase, so there will be no in-person activities, meetings, or studies at the church this week. And you can continue giving your offering either through mail at 885 Pembina Trail or by giving online at dlumc.org. Thank you.
It came upon the midnight clear, that glorious song of old, from angels bending near the earth to touch their harps of gold. Peace on the earth, goodwill to men, from hands of gracious King. The world in solemn stillness lay to hear the angels sing. Still through the cloven skies they come, with peaceful wings unfurled, and still their heavenly music floats o'er all the weary world. Above its sad and lonely plains they bend on hovering wing, and ever o'er its bevel sounds the blessed angels sing. And ye beneath life's crushing load, whose forms are bending low, who toil along the climbing way with painful steps and slow, look now for glad and golden hours come swiftly on the wing. Oh, rest beside the weary road and hear the angels sing. For lo, the days are hastening on, by prophets seen of old, when with the ever-circling years shall come the time foretold, when peace shall over all the earth its ancient splendors fling, and the whole world send back the song which now the angels sing. sing.
And now go forth into the world. Know that God loves you and blesses you. Be that mission force of Christians who tells the story, who share the joy, and who invite people in to be a part of the story. In the name of Christ we pray. Amen.
Thank you.